Hi, I'm Richard Feldman, creator of the Rock programming language and a full-time Rust programmer at Zed. I created this course because I wanted people to understand how a compiler actually works. That's from type checking all the way to code generation. We're going to start off building a code formatter, which if you think about it, is kind of like a simple compiler. Then we're going to move on to name resolution, followed by type checking and type inference. And then finally, we're going to wrap up with code generation all the way to WebAssembly. By the end of the course, you'll understand how a real static type checking compiler works. And if you want, you could even go on to build your own. So in this section, we're going to talk about Lexing, aka tokenization, also scanning, I've heard, less commonly, parsing, and formatting. Okay, so we'll start with Lexing. This is typically what most compilers will start out with. You don't have to start out this way, but it's so common that we're going to do it in this compiler and just talk very briefly about how it's done. So here's the basic idea. We have some source code here. Let's say this is our source code. It says const x equals 5. This is valid source code in our language. I forgot to mention earlier we support comments. And then we have a comment afterwards that says x equals 5. So the first thing that we're going to do, and basically that every compiler does, is like, we've got this source code format, and it is really inconvenient to try to write a compiler on top of just source code. So let's try to get it into some other representation that is going to make our lives easier as compiler authors. So the first thing that we do is we basically start marching through the string and trying to find interesting, they call them tokens, like basically little chunks of text that are sort of semantically interesting to us that we can make a nice tree out of eventually when we get to parsing, and then we can traverse that tree and do our analysis in a much more nicely semantic way. So C-O-N-S-T, that's what our Lexer sees, and it says, oh, I know what that is. This is a const token. So this is how we would represent that in our language. You just make a JavaScript record object. By the way, the compiler is going to be written in JavaScript, the compiler subset of JavaScript. So we would have an object here, and we have a field called type, and the type is going to be const in all caps. The reason I put these in all caps is just to kind of indicate that, like, hey, these are tokens. These are not like the actual syntax, so you can kind of tell when you see the all caps thing, that means this is like the name of the token as opposed to like the actual syntax. We could have named this anything. We could have said like, I am a const thing, whatever. This is, you know, referring to that, but not actually coming from the source. The value for this is null. We'll see later on, actually immediately after this, some tokens have a value associated with them. Like for example, this token has a value of x associated with it. And then position here is basically like, where in the original file can this be found, like in the actual source code? This comes up for things like error messages. If you want to print out nice, helpful error messages to your users, people generally want to know, like, okay, but where in the source code is that? You could be like, I found a type error. And you're like, where was the type error? And you're like, it's a string, and it was supposed to be a number. You got to guess where. So yeah, if you want to be able to give people nice error messages, you really got to propagate through the subsequent steps of compilation where the actual source code position is. This is not something I'm going to show on every slide because it gets kind of tedious to have like position all over the place. But just keep in mind that like in a real production grade compiler, we would be basically propagating the original source code position of things like all the way through, starting from tokenization, all the way through pretty much the entire pipeline. Anything that could possibly give a user an error at compile time is going to be connected back to the source code if you want to be able to show them the source code. All right, so the next token our Lexer is going to see it, like, it's like, all right, we got the const, great, we parsed past, skipped past, like, whatever white space was there, and now we found this thing called x. It's not a keyword, it's not an equal sign, it's not a number. Okay, this must be an identifier. So identifier is basically a general term for sort of something that's sort of like the user came up with it. So this is like either it could be like a variable like this, or it could be a function argument name, or it could be a function name. Could even be like a field. Some languages will or will not have separate tokens for like fields and objects, like with a colon after them, versus just identifiers outside of that. In our case, we're not even supporting objects, so we don't have that problem to think about. So unlike the const one, this one actually does have a value because there are different types of identifiers. The whole point of them is that they're sort of coming from user space. This is something that the user typed in. They could have put X or Y or Z or, you know, whatever else you want. And so we want to store that in our actual token. But a lot of tokens, such as equals, don't have anything to store. So for those, we just say value null. And notice that the position keeps moving up, right? We're now eight characters into our source code. Some compilers will store this as like a line and column numbers. One reason to do that is that, that can be nice for like if you're printing out on the command line, but also that's what like language server protocol expects is like line and column numbers. Unfortunately, it expects them in like UTF-16 format, which is really annoying, but because everybody wants to use UTF-8 for their source code encoding. But you also can do it as just like writing down the index of, you know, however many bytes or characters you are in. That also works, and you can convert to line and column later on if you want to, just by kind of doing a very quick rescan for like new lines, basically. That's what Zig's compiler does, for example. And then finally, we have the number 5. So this is not an identifier, although it does come from the user space. We actually do, and this is also very common, do some sort of analysis to like look at the shape of this user-provided thing that's not a keyword or an equals or whatever. And be like, okay, wait, this looks like a number literal to us. So it's useful to us later on to make that distinction. So you may have noticed that basically no programming languages will allow you to start a variable name with a number. I mean, I'm sure there are they exist. But one of the reasons for this is that it's very, very convenient and also good for performance if when you're doing the Lexing stage, you can be like, if I see something that starts with a number, great, this is a number. I don't need to be like, well, wait a minute. What might have been a really funky variable name. Let's just hang on. Really, really a lot nicer if you can just be like, yeah, no, that's a number. I see a digit, it's a number. And then finally we have a comment. So a lot of compilers and especially like teaching compilers, like we're building a sort of a toy compiler here, we'll just discard comments at this stage and we'll just throw them away. We are not going to do that because we are building a formatter. And if you're building a formatter, you need to keep the comments. If you throw them away, then they don't get formatted. They just get thrown in the garbage, which is really bad for a formatter. So I mentioned in the beginning of the workshop that we are doing Hindley-Milner type inference. This is how you spell Hindley-Milner, if you're ever wondering. This is named after two famous computer scientists, Hindley and Milner. Robin Milner is famous for all sorts of things. Hindley, I think, is mainly just famous for this algorithm. There's also, you might see Damas Hindley-Milner, or DMS for short, because Damas got involved later. But usually, the most common way that I hear people refer to this style of type checking is Hindley-Milner. So why are we using it in this course? Well, first off, it's a real-world production like type inference system. It's not just like a toy thing. This is like used by production languages like Helm, Haskell, Rock. Like basically, the like functional programming, like typed functional programming languages, tend to use Hindley-Milner type inference among like languages that see like real-world production use. So it's not like the most popular way to do it, but it does have a lot of nice properties. And in some cases, people will say, "I wish that the language that I were using were using Hindley-Milner inference because it does have some very nice properties, such as." It has a simple type system. Now, the word simple can mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people. In this case, what I mean basically is that you don't have subtyping to deal with, which means you don't have to worry about covariance, contravariance, or any of the other implications of subtyping. Now, subtyping can be quite nice for ergonomics in some cases. It can be something where like you kind of expect something to work, and then if you have a subtyping type checker or type system, it just works the way that you expect it to. And the fact that Hindley-Milner is not a subtyping type system generally tends to mean that like you might have some language features that you would find in other languages that you don't find in languages that have this. So for example, like Go interfaces would be an example of this. Like that's a subtyping thing where you say, I'm defining this interface and anybody who matches this interface can just like instantly use this function, call this function without needing to change my types in any way or add any type variables or anything like that. There are ways you can be equally flexible, but in Hindley-Milner, you usually end up incorporating a type variable to do that level of flexibility. Whereas if you have subtyping, you don't need to put a type variable or a type parameter in your type annotation. So Hindley-Milner type inference, or at least a lot of languages that use Hindley-Milner tend to be sound, meaning that there is no concept in the language of a runtime type mismatch. So an example of a runtime type mismatch would be you're coming along in your JavaScript code and you call a function, but it wasn't a function. It was a string for some reason. And you get a type mismatch at runtime that was like, I'm trying to call a string. You can't do that. You can't call strings. You can only call functions. And somehow you got a string here in this variable that you thought was a function, but actually at runtime it wasn't. So a sound type checker is one where before the program runs, it tells you about every single instance of things like that. There is no such thing in this language as a runtime type mismatch. As we'll see when we get to code generation, there isn't even like code that could report one because there's just not a thing. So that's a very nice property of these languages. A lot of production type checkers today are not sound. Java is not sound. TypeScript is famously intentionally unsound. I think Java had some like soundness holes that they found that were not intentional. I think having to do with reflection. But basically, it's like it is possible to write a Java program in a way where you get runtime type mismatches that the compiler didn't catch. TypeScript was intentionally unsound because they wanted to cover a very wide range of existing JavaScript code bases, including some that are using things that essentially were either impossible or at least impractical to be able to catch type mismatches at compile time. Hindley-Milner type inference is decidable. And what decidable means is that it can figure out, it can infer all of the types for your program like all of them. You do not need to write type annotations. And in fact, in this workshop, just to emphasize this, I made type annotations essentially an afterthought. So the very last thing at the very end of all the type checking sections that we do is we just like kind of sneak type annotations in there and talk about how they work, and then that's it. So by the time we get to them, we've already made everything else work just using type inference with no annotations. It's all sound, it's all decidable, and it all just works. It's also polymorphic, so that means that it can support generics. So we will get to things like you can say, I have an array of strings or I have an array of numbers, and that is like a, you know, that type variable, that type parameter thing that, you know, a lot of languages, again, going back to Go, like for a long time, Go didn't have generics, and this was like a famous, like, you know, hullabaloo, and then eventually they added generics, and when they, what they added were the form of generics known as parametric polymorphism, which is exactly the type of thing that we're doing here. And parametric polymorphism is basically, some people use it interchangeably with the term generics, although generics usually has a little bit more of an object-oriented connotation to it. Parametric polymorphism is just like the most general, like, you got type parameters now, and they're a thing. And that's what we're doing here. That's what all the functional languages that use Hindley-Milner inference use, and works great. So basically what we're going to do is we're going to talk a little bit upfront about sort of like general concepts of generating bytecode. Then most of what we're gonna talk about right here is we're just gonna like walk through the code and talk through at a very high level what it's doing. And then, you know, feel free to ask questions. And then we're gonna get back and talk about polymorphic functions. The main point of this course is all the stuff building up to this. And as we're gonna see in a second, once you get the basic idea of this, I think that's like the vast majority of the benefit, at least for this, the purposes of this course, is just like kind of understanding like, how does this actually work? And you can get the idea pretty quickly, I think, based on what we've already learned. Okay. As we've talked about before, we have this recurring theme, and this will be the last time the theme recurs because this is the last section of traversing input and generating output. So start off with source string, do some lexing, get out some tokens, take the tokens, parse them, we get a parse tree, do some naming on that, and then we get scope involved, do some type inference on that, and then we get back our type database. And now we are finally ready for the final stage, which is taking the parse tree and code gen to a string. Just kidding. That's not what we're doing now. That's what we already did. What we already did when we did formatting was we basically ran through these steps, and okay, granted, we didn't have naming and type inference there, but we could, if we wanted to, choose to do those. Like, if you wanted to, you could have your formatter be like, oh yeah, do, like, tell me about naming errors and tell me about all the types. It's not going to use them. It doesn't need them. Those are sort of optional as far as the formatter is concerned, but fundamentally, you could just do all these steps if you wanted to with the formatter. And then, of course, if you wanted to take an actual step further, then we would, instead of generating a string at the end because it's a formatter, we would keep everything else the same, except that now we are generating WebAssembly bytecode. And you might have noticed I did sneak something in here, which was the formatter only cares about the parse tree as its input. But if we're generating WebAssembly bytecode, we actually do need to know that type database, because finally it has come to pass that we do finally get some value out of storing all of those IDs in our parse tree nodes way back in the day when we were like back in like section two. Now we finally get to use them. So now the fact that we have those IDs in our parse tree nodes and we have this fully populated type DB means that not only do we know the structure of the nodes, like where's the conditionals, where are the functions defined, yada, yada, but also we know what the types of absolutely every single thing in our program is. We know the type of everything. There is nothing in our program where the type is a mystery to us at this point, because we did complete type inference on all of it. So now, ready to generate some WebAssembly bytecode. And that's good, because WebAssembly bytecode is typed. Like, WebAssembly actually requires you to explicitly specify the types. Some bytecodes do not, but machine code also doesn't require that you specify it, but it does require that you know it, because if you don't know it or you get it wrong, bad things happen. So essentially, whether you're going to WebAssembly bytecode or machine code, you basically need to know your types at this point, or you need to do something like the aforementioned other languages that will do some like runtime extra work where they will like wrap up the type information around the thing. So you'll have like, not only is this a string, but there's also a little piece of information hanging off the side that says, I'm a string. And so if you know where that little piece of extra information is consistently, you can go ask at runtime. But of course, there's performance implications to that and all that good stuff. So because we have all of our types, we don't need to do that at runtime. We already know what all the types are, and we can just tell into WebAssembly directly and have it run faster. Okay, now it is time for the WebAssembly code tour. So basically what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna sort of walk through our solution here. And if you take a peek ahead of, I guess if you're gonna peek, you could always cheat, but looking at the exercise, we might end up going through the thing that is in the exercise anyway, but we only have this one WebAssembly implementation. So here we go, let's take a look through it. So fundamentally, what WebAssembly is doing is to recap what we said like at the very beginning, what you end up with when you have code generated some WebAssembly is you end up with a whole bunch of bytes. There's a bunch of ones and zeros. If you try to read them as a human, you look at that and you go, this is a bunch of gibberish. I see a string there. Okay, but then more gibberish. I don't really know what to make of any of this. This is not designed to be human readable. What it's designed to be streamed efficiently over the network. That's really what its job is. So it can be decoded over the network as it's coming in and then translated directly or JITted, just in time compiled directly into machine code. So like I said, the main reason that we're doing this in WebAssembly rather than in machine code is, number one, if we did it in machine code, then I'd have to have a different version for everybody's different like machine that you're running. So I'd have to have a version of this for like x86 64 Intel machines and another one for like 64-bit ARM machines. And the amount of work that would have to go into this section is like a lot bigger. But also just because like WebAssembly honestly is a little bit simpler to understand than those things. A lot of those architectures are like very old. They have a lot of legacy stuff going on. Whereas WebAssembly is a lot more modern and the way it's organized is like a little bit more streamlined.